I'm Richard Coulter, head of marketing for Fujitsu Network Business, and I'm here with Joe Christofik, head of product planning for network automation. Joe came in to talk to us today about a really timely topic, how artificial intelligence and machine learning are being used to help automate operations. We really appreciate your time today. Thanks for coming in, Joe.
Great to be here, Rich.
All right, so before you came to Fujitsu, I understand that you worked with one of the big tier one mobile network operators in North America. And I hoped you could share a little bit about that experience and how there are complex operations problems that you had to be involved in, and kind of what you learned from that and how it defines and drives what you do today.
Sure, that's correct. Working at a tier one operator, you had the chance to see firsthand how you manage networks, the problem areas and the challenges that are on the network today. And primarily for managing the network, if you think about operations, they're the backstop for the network from a technology perspective, adoption into the network, but then also managing a legacy network. And so that becomes challenging as we start rolling out new technologies. How are we managing the network? And so these challenges that come to the operations team are really, how do we reduce the time to repair a network? How do we reduce catastrophic events on the network to serve clients? And in this market today, losing clients and churn is a real big topic. And so their job becomes very important and challenging to meet those expectations of the customer.
Absolutely. And you talked about reducing churn and making sure that customers stay on the network, which is a critical thing for the mobile network operators. Now, what are some of the things that drive customers away? Problems in the network. What drives the reduction in churn? And how does the operations get involved with that?
Well, I think the expectation today with a network, it's almost a commodity. So you don't expect any outages. You don't expect any service degradation on your network. And so anytime that happens on the network, you have the opportunity, or not opportunity, but possibility to lose customers. And so understanding that the new technology rollouts and how they are operating over the course and serving your customers is really important for the operations team. And then reducing the time to repair, like I mentioned, when events do take place on the network, and being able to address them and understand a resolution more rapidly than we've done in the past.
Absolutely. So you talked about events. So let's talk about a specific type of event, an alarm storm. I hope you could tell us what an alarm storm is, what kind of characterizes it, the frequency of alarms, et cetera, maybe just walk us through that.
Sure. So if you think about a network operating in steady state, you may have a few alarms raised and closed here, not severe, and you're monitoring a network, and then all of a sudden there's a rapid increase in alarms. And typically these come from a certain specific location in the topology of the network, but they could impact other parts of the network. And so you'll see a rise of alarms that are raising on the networks. Often they could also be raised and closed, going back and forth, flapping the alarm state. And so when that happens on the network, it's how fast can we find, where's this problem coming from? And with the introduction of virtualization, servers, the different service layers, and then also the hardware and platforms that support traditional networking, when these come together, a problem becomes very challenging to solve and really identify where's the location of this issue, and then how do we solve that as fast as possible.
That sounds really complicated. Are we talking about a few alarms? Like when you say rapid increase, what's the scale of those types of alarms?
Sure. Well, depending on the network size, being a global operator or nationwide operator, you could be looking into the hundreds of thousands of alarms just over the course of a few weeks and months. And then over the course of months, from a segment of the network into the millions of alarms. So these alarms are going off. They go off in the network. And when you have that rapid increase in alarms that are closely related to one another, they take place on different parts of the network. And so being able to pull those apart and understand what's going on in this part of the network versus this part of the network, it becomes very challenging for an operations team to manage.
Yeah, it sounds just a nightmare to untangle. What is the process the operations team actually goes through to sort that out, to figure out what's causing the alarm and get the network back up and running?
Sure. Well, today there's still much application of traditional processes, manual interventions, manual policies baked into automations. And so one challenge that we've had over the course of network is just identifying what's the event. Can we suppress some alarms so we can get into a certain bucket of alarms and spaces to look at? So doing some automations, but those are traditionally built on policies, manual, you know, policies of operation experts that look at it. So these can change over time. The way the network interacts together and behaviors can change over time. So it becomes challenging, and what may worked, you know, last year may not work as well this year with the adoption of new technology. And so they use those automations to raise up events, learn a little bit more about them, and then they traditionally go into the EMS platforms. And when we're looking at multi-vendor networks and server virtualization, you're going into many back office systems, tools, and EMS platforms when it comes to these events. And some of the challenges with that are you can go down the wrong path. You can go down one path that you may think the event is sourced from some root cause, and you spend hours doing that, and you've lost hours that you could have otherwise been looking and addressing right at the root cause.
Yeah, that just sounds super challenging. And from the legacy point of view, that time is really critical, especially if, you know, it always has to be on. So talk to us a little bit about, you know, what are the new methods you're seeing with artificial intelligence, machine learning, and how they're helping to automate, you know, that troubleshooting.
Mm-hmm. Well, AI brings in new technology and algorithms to look at this data set. If we, you know, we talked about the scale of these data sets, and so to process and understand these alarms and behaviors and patterns, AI is really a great fit for that. The algorithms can learn and evolve over time. So leveraging, for example, a neural network, giving it inputs, having it understand outputs that you ask of that neural network, whether it's root cause or about a specific event, and learn from your network and evolve over time. Having that kind of architecture in place, it really fits well to such a large data set like alarms and behaviors that are on the network. So we'll start to see more AI baked into the tools around the automation and leveraging those type of algorithms, whether it's neural networks, anomaly detections for alarms and log messages that take place on the network, large language models, LLM, so kind of a ChatGPT style management of the network as well.
Yeah, that's exciting. And then those technologies are so much in the news today. Can you give us a brief introduction to Fujitsu's solution to this, Storm Chaser, and just talk us through that a little bit?
Sure, yeah. So Storm Chaser really packages that automation together, leveraging AI. And so Storm Chaser brings to the table the ability to ingest and look at large-scale alarms processed in time, learn from your history of your network, provide reinforcement training, so the ability to learn from what you've seen on the network, apply it back into a model, and evolve with the network over time. So these are the things that we didn't have with manual policy interventions on networks. Not just identifying the event, but giving you information, interpreting events, and pinpointing locations to investigate with recommendation engines. So that's how Fujitsu's approaching the solution with Storm Chaser. We want to bridge the gap from the long lead times to mean time to repair and resolution identification, and bring that to the forefront of when these storms take place. And over the course of many storms happening on the network, and the aggregation of that is the real value behind Storm Chaser running around in the background.
Yeah. So that's great. So now with, you know, legacy was really manual. You're looking through EMSs and trying to troubleshoot and using knowledge to figure out how to narrow down to what the problem is. Tell us a little bit more about Storm Chaser and how that's helping to automate that troubleshooting root cause analysis.
Well, I think the process, if you just look at it from leveraging AI and automation together, is looking at that data set from a data perspective on these alarms when they take place on the network, understanding what steady state looks like, what a good network representation looks like, and then seeing when these alarm storms take place, really understanding them, and then being able to leverage the virtualization capabilities of today cost efficiently and leveraging AI models to understand where are these alarms coming from? Have we seen similar occasions on the network? Can we learn from what we've seen on the network and apply that in real seconds and provide some valuable insights back to the operator of the network? I think that's what we'll see start to play out from AI and the network.
Yeah, that's really exciting. It sounds like a whole new world for the network operations team. I mean, what do you think that means to network operation teams and how they're going to function differently over time?
Sure. I think operations teams are going to start to see an evolution, moving from the manual process and policies that they've used traditionally to suppress alarms and raise up events. That only goes so far. That says, hey, there's an event happening here. We've refined it down. But you still need to go look into 5 different EMSs from different vendors, and you need to know what's going on in the network and have that knowledge. I think that segment of the application is going to evolve with software. And operators are going to have at their disposal tools that can interpret that information for you. So we've identified events, but now the interpretation of it, what are we seeing here? Can you tell me what I'm seeing? And it's going to be more contextual. You're going to see tools that can look at data and tie that into resource documentation, leveraging, for example, LLMs into that. And how can we understand what's going on in the network more from a contextualized perspective and then take fast resolution actions from there moving forward? So it certainly doesn't eliminate the management of the network with operations teams. I think that their role is going to evolve with the tools. And that's how it's been over the course of the industry in general. So I think we're going to leverage tools. They're going to provide more information, and we're going to be able to do things faster and manage the network more efficiently.
That's really exciting and interesting. You know, it just the network itself is evolving so much over the past 10 years, and now with these new tools and new technologies, we're going to see more and more rapid innovation. And it's just exciting to see how AI, this technology that we've been hearing so much, is being applied in real-world use cases to networking. So thanks, Joe, for stopping by and talking to us about AI-enabled operations. It's really an exciting topic, and we appreciate your time.
All right, thank you.